Hello everyone. In this video, I'm going to cover the operational cost of the online bookstore application I created a couple of days back. After I released that video, I got a lot of questions from you guys asking about the cost of this architecture. And I couldn't cover the cost aspects in that video, so that's why I thought of creating a new video about it so that it will be useful to you. By the way, if you haven't watched that video, I'll post a link up here, so better watch it first, otherwise this video won't make much sense to you. So without further ado, let's start our discussion. And hey, my name is Manoj, and in this channel I create videos to solve different problems when you start using AWS in your production projects. So if that sounds interesting to you, make sure you subscribe to my channel for more videos just like this. So how much is it going to cost us? Now these are the components that we will be charged. We have an API, the GraphQL API powered by AppSync, and we have two Lambda functions, if you can remember. Now one function is to process the payments, and then the other one is to create orders. And if you have multiple other functions, like let's say to send the invoice to the customer, the costing can be calculated in the same manner. I will show you in a bit. And we have a DynamoDB table to store books, book orders, and don't forget we have secondary indexes as well. And we have the Cognito user pool to hold our users. And then we have two S3 buckets, the website hosting S3 bucket and another S3 bucket to hold our images, the book images. And this is the architecture I discussed in the last video. Now I have highlighted the AppSync or the GraphQL API. So here in this architecture we have two Lambda functions, so that process the payment, and then we have the DynamoDB table, the Cognito here for authentication and authorization, and then we have the two S3 buckets. So let's focus on the AppSync and how much is it going to cost us. Now this is a pricing table for AppSync, and these figures are directly taken from AppSync pricing page. You can visit this link and have a look at it. So in our application, what we will be mainly charged against is the queries and the mutations and the data transfer charges, because we are not using any real-time updates, like, you know, subscription also, and we don't use caching as well. So we will be mainly charged for queries and mutation and data transfers. By the way, if you are under the free tier, then you will get these benefits and you won't be charged unless you exceed 250,000 queries or mutations. So to calculate the cost, we need to have some kind of a scenario. So here's a scenario that I want to calculate cost against. Let's say our bookstore receives 1 million queries or mutation per month. I mean, our bookstore is really popular, so we get so many queries. People search for books, admins will create books and so on, but most of these are probably from the queries because people search books. And also let's imagine the average response size for a request is about 5 kilobytes. So that means if you search for a book and if you make a query, then you will get 5 kilobytes of data in return. So considering these figures, let's calculate the cost for our API. Query operation charges. So either case, whether they are queries or mutations, for these 1 million requests, it's going to be charged $4. Because if I go to the previous page, for 1 million requests, you will be charged $4. And then we have the data transfer charges. Now this is charged for the data coming into AWS and going out of AWS. And there are several tiers for this. And let me show you the pricing for these tiers. And here in this page, this is the pricing for EC2 instances. But we use AppSync, but behind the scene, I think it is also using EC2. So that's what they are referencing this page from AppSync page. So all data transfer that is coming from outside to AWS, there won't be any charge. When the data is going out of AWS to internet, then there will be certain tiers. So up to 1 GB of data, so it is $0. But if it is more than 1 GB and less than, let's say, 10 terabyte, for each gigabyte of data, you will be charged $0.09. So here's the calculation. So 5 kilobyte into 1 million requests, so that is 1 million kilobyte. So that is equal to 4.8 gigabytes. So this is well under 10 terabytes. So you will be charged 0.09, so that equals to 0.4. And altogether, this is $4.4. So that's our AppSync API charges. Now I want to point out something else real quick as well. The AppSync API accesses the proxy for our backend functions. So it is pretty much the same if you use a REST API. For example, if you have a API gateway replacing AppSync, so it is also acting as another proxy. For API gateway to process 1 million requests, it is $3.5. So it is like $0.5 cheaper than AppSync. Okay, so let's move on to our functions. So we have two functions, makePayment lambda and the createOrder lambda. So lambda is going to charge us $2 per million request. So that means if you get 1 million requests to a lambda function, you get charged $2. But there is a free tier, and this is a monthly free tier. So every month this will be refreshed. So every month 1 million requests will be free of charge. And apart from these request prices, you will also be charged for the duration, and that is counted as gigabyte seconds. There's a pricing table for these gigabyte seconds as well. Let's imagine that you allocated 512 megabytes of RAM for each of your lambda functions. So we have two lambda functions. Each one of that is allocated 512 megabytes of memory. And as you know, only the variable that you can tweak for a lambda is the memory. And if you allocate more memory, it will allocate more CPU power as well. Now, these two lambda functions are related to order processing flow. So that means if a customer makes an order, then these get executed. So let's imagine we get 500,000 orders per month. I mean, it's a big number. And let's assume it takes 1 second to process the request. So for our first lambda, to process the payment with Stripe, it takes 1 second. The other one, to make the order in the DynamoDB table, it takes 1 second. Okay, now this is the price that we have to pay for 1 gigabyte second. So this is $0.00016667. So let's calculate how many gigabyte seconds do we have. And mind you that there's a 400,000 gigabyte second fee for a month. So the total compute seconds. So 500,000 into 1 second because it runs for 1 second and 500,000 seconds. So this 500,000 is the number of time that this lambda function get executed. So then let's compute the gigabyte seconds. So let's multiply these 500,000 seconds with 512 megabyte because our lambda function is 512, and then we'll divide it by 1024. That will convert into gigabyte seconds. This is about 250,000 gigabyte seconds. And we have two lambda functions that executes one after the other. So we have to multiply it by 2. Then again we get 500,000 gigabyte seconds. And once we deduct the free tier amount, so that is 400,000 gigabyte second, we get 100,000 gigabyte seconds. And this 100,000 gigabyte second, we have to multiply it by its unit price, and then we get $1.67. Okay, now this is our lambda compute charges. So what about our lambda request charges? Now, since we get only 100,000 requests, we are well in the free tier because there's a 1 million free tier. So we don't get charged anything. So it is $0. So that's it for our lambda charges. Next, let's look at our DynamoDB table. Now in DynamoDB, there are two modes of pricing. So one is the on-demand mode and the other one is provision mode. Now provision mode has been the first method that was introduced in DynamoDB, but then they came up with on-demand pricing. So the difference is you don't have to provision capacity for your table, but they will be on demand. If you get so many requests to your database, it will increase the capacity, the write capacity and the read capacity for your table and accommodate that requests. So in on-demand mode, if you don't get any request, write or read request, you won't be charged. But in the provision mode, you anyway have to pay for the provision amount. So in DynamoDB, we get charged for three main things in our application. Write request, when you're writing thing to the database, and reading it, you know, the read books and all, and then the data storage. And there's a really good free tier offer for storage. The first 25 GB is free in every month. So that's a general offer. So let's look at another scenario. So according to our very first example, we get 1 million requests. So let's consider these are queries. And let's imagine the average item size is about 4 kilobytes. And the total table size does not exceed 25 GB. Now having these assumptions, we can calculate the charge for reading from book table. So the read request is, you know, we get 1 million queries, so 1 million requests into $0.25. So that is the charge for reading 1 million data items, and each one of those data items can be of 8 kilobytes. Now this is eventual consistent read, so it allows up to 8 kilobytes, whereas our actual item size is 4 kilobytes. So we can again divide it by 2 or multiply by 0.5, so that is $0.625. And if you are reading so many books, then item size will be higher. Then you have to multiply it by the corresponding multiplier. So that's about reading from the book table. So how about writing to the order table? So how many orders do we have? We have 100,000 orders. And then that is 0.1 million. And for 1 million writes, it is going to cost $1.25. And this is for writing 1 kilobyte of data, but our payload, let's imagine we are writing 4 kilobytes of data, so we have to multiply it by 4 times. And you will also be writing to the book order table, so that would be a similar calculation, $5. And don't forget, guys, we have to calculate for GSIs as well, because we have two GSIs, and GSI operates as a separate table, so you have to calculate the same write costs for that as well. So that is 0.1, 1.25 into 4, and then we have two of these, so we multiply it by 2, it is $10 in total. So approximately the total is about $20. But these are very rough estimation, and as you can understand, it all depends on the average item size, how much data that is received from the backend. So that's about DynamoDB. Then let's move on to our Cognito, the user pool, and it is basically for free, guys. Why I say it is free, like it provides 50,000 monthly active users for free. Now, a user is considered as active user if we logged into your application within a month. And let's say I am a user, I logged into application and I did not log in to that application until end of this year. So then I am not considered as a active user. So let's say the bookstore has only 25,000 monthly active users, but still again the price is zero. Then finally, let's look at our S3 bucket charges. So we have two S3 buckets, and here we are using standard S3 storage. And let's imagine we have 2,000 books in S3, and the total image size of all those book images is about 50 gigabytes. So in S3 standard storage, up to 50 terabyte, you will be charged $0.023 per gigabyte. So we are well under 50 terabytes because it's only 50 gigabyte. We'll multiply it by this amount, so that equals to $1.15. And not only that, but also we'll be charged for the GET request, the request to get these objects. So in S3, you will be charged $0.0004 for every 1,000 GET requests. So we'll convert 1 million divided by 1,000 to get the 1,000 bunch, and then multiply by this, and then we get $0.4. So that equals to $1.55. So if we get the total cost, so it would be equal to $27 per month. Now, as you have already seen, most of these costs coming from DynamoDB. So you have to be carefully design how much data that you are querying, and also how many GSIs that you are setting up for your applications. So those things has to be really considered when you are designing your DynamoDB tables. Okay, so that's it for our pricing video. I hope it has been useful. And remember, guys, this unit value will be different from region to region as well. So my recommendation is for you to go to the pricing pages of DynamoDB, S3 and all that, and then estimate the cost for your application. So don't depend on these values, okay? So that's it, guys. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in another video.